Hello and welcome to another episode in the Godot Basics tutorial series. In this episode, we will be taking a quick look at nodes and scenes. To refresh your memory from the GDScript Fundamental tutorial series, we know that a node class inherits from the object class. Therefore, it does not remove itself from memory even if nothing is referenced to it. However, if a node is removed from the scene, it will queue itself for memory release, and it will do the same for all its children. Now, unlike the node class, nodes are something completely different. Nodes are the core of Godot. As a matter of fact, all games are based on nodes and scenes. Now, a node by itself is useless. As a matter of fact, you'll find with Godot that you'll need to combine multiple nodes together in order to get certain functionality. Nodes can also have multiple nodes underneath them. And as a matter of fact, this results in a tree-like structure. So one rule to know is that a single node can have multiple children, but multiple children can only have one parent. And on top of that, the nodes and the children need to have their own unique names. So again, nodes need to have one parent, and this is where we get our tree-like structure. As a matter of fact, a node without a parent is called the root node. And on top of that, nodes inherit the transforms of their parents. You can consider that the parent position as the origin that all children nodes revolve around. So one thing to note is that the root node should manage creation and deletion of their children. On top of that, all scenes need a root node. You can also think of a root node as a manager class. Basically, you manage the creation and deletion of your child nodes. Now, this is what a node tree and scene looks like. As you can see here, we have the scene tab. The plus sign allows us to add new nodes onto the scene. And on top of that, you can only have one root node, which is again a node without a parent. And notice how we have children. In this case, the node2D child, kinematic parent, sprite child, and collision child. And just from the look of this image, we can see the tree-like structure where our root node is our beginning and everything basically branches out from there. One thing to note is that nodes are drawn in tree order. So we will get to take a look at this in a future episode. However, just note that as long as your node is towards the bottom in the tree-like structure of our scene, the nodes towards the bottom have priority in the drawing sequence over the top. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. Let's pretend all of these nodes are actually sprites. We'll just use our imagination for now. But our tree structure is the same. Let's go ahead and take a look at an example. So imagine each of these nodes has an image and our tree structure is the same as the previous slide. Well, first what we do is we grab our first node in the scene and we go ahead and draw that onto our game. And then we move down the line and we draw that next, and we draw the third one next, the fourth one next, and the last thing to be drawn to the scene will be number 5. And whatever image is in our node at the 5th level will be at the front of the game in terms of priority, and the image that was drawn first, in this case the root node, will be drawn in the back because it was drawn first, and therefore everything drawn after that gets drawn on top of our root node. Let's go ahead and talk about scenes. So a tree of nodes is called a scene, and every scene must have one root. On top of that, scenes can be saved to disk and instanced into other scenes. As a matter of fact, if you want to run a game, you must have at least one scene. Moving on, a single project can have multiple scenes. And on top of that, scenes can be switched, loaded, and reloaded. Now, to add a new scene that we can add nodes to, we need to create a file with the file name extension .tscn. And that would be short for text scene. Now, one cool feature is that we can use a scene tree to organize our nodes into groups. In other game engines such as Unity, we would call that a prefab. And on top of groups, we can actually create something called groups, which we'll take a look at in a future episode. So why are scenes important? Well, for one thing, we can create proper games. And I put proper in quotations. And as a matter of fact, a proper game is whatever game you want to make. However, if you plan on selling on iOS or Android, they are expecting a more rounded, sand all the edges kind of game. And so let's go ahead and take a look at that. In a, again, in quotations, proper game, we have a splash screen. You can have your company image or the Godot logo. And from there, we move into our main menu scene, and that holds all of our buttons, gives us, or rather gives the player choices to pick what to do. And the player can choose to, one, play the game by entering the game scene, or perhaps they want to look at credits, and so they choose to go into the scrolling credits scene. As you can see, we can use scenes to make a more rounded kind of game. And games can even have scenes inside of them. So think of a game like Mario. When you press play, you enter the Mario world, you pick your level, and the level picker is your scene, right? World 1, World 2. And then once you pick your world, or rather, once you pick your level, you enter another scene, and that's the level you are playing. So that's just an example of how we can use scenes to create games. Now, so far, we just went over theory. In the next episode, we will look into the scene system. Now, that's all I have for you in this episode. Thank you so much for joining me. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to leave them in the comment section down below. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.